What up though, I'm Murs, HipHopDX, and this is The Breakdown. Over the past couple of months that I've had the pleasure of doing these breakdowns for y'all, we've had some pretty spirited discourse and a lot of heated debates. Most common of the comments tends to be about what is and what isn't real hip-hop. Most purists will be quick to tell you that acts like KRS-One and Joey Badass are real hip-hop, and acts like Migos and Future are not. But what does that make them? Fake hip-hop? This conversation has been going on for generations, but today we attempt to settle it once and for all. Real hip-hop versus fake hip-hop, and is there even a difference? Let's break it down. KRS-One, the most prominent and celebrated hip-hop scholar in the world, aka The Teacher. Founder of the Temple of Hip-Hop, he's recorded several albums, quite a few considered to be classics, written a handful of books, the main one being The Gospel of Hip-Hop. He still rocks stages like no other, but he also rocks speaking engagements at prestigious universities to community centers all around the world. Known for his catchphrase, "The real hip-hop is over here," here's his definition of hip-hop.
Just the term hip-hop. Hip means to know, hop is movement. Awareness, movement, consciousness, and movement, or action. Intelligence and action, activity. So hip and hop, or hip-hop, means conscious movement.
All respect due, but I beg to differ. I think he was completely right about the term hop, but as many of us do, I think he bent the term hip to fit his definition. As I know it, the term hip means to be with it or up on it. Hip cats know what's good, and if you don't know what's good, you need to get hip. In my digging, I found footage from a former member of the Black Spades. Many members of this gang would go on to found the Zulu Nation. This former member of the Baby Spades had this to say about the term hip hop.
That term hip hop, it was a derisive term originally. And it really referred to us as B-boys because of the way we danced and, you know, we're wearing sneakers and, you know, clubs don't like that shit.
Right.
You know what I mean? You know, the Black, they wanted to feel they mature, and even teenagers who wanted to feel they were more adult, more mature.
Right.
They kind of looked down on us. They looked down on us as thugs, and they called us hippity hoppers and boing-oings and floor sweepers. They had negative terms for us. They didn't like what we were doing.
According to him, hip-hop was a derisive term used by the disco crowd to downplay the new movement that was on the come up. Basically, older heads talking down on younger heads. Mumble rap versus real rap? Sound familiar to anyone? Peers will be quick to tell you that sex, drugs, violence, and materialism have no place in real hip-hop. Yet, hip-hop was founded by kids in the ghettos and projects of America, some of whom were former or active gang members and criminals. So a lot of these original B-boys, DJs, MCs, and graffiti writers could have been stick-up kids, drug dealers, drug users, or even killers. We have to do away with the fantasy and folklore that tells us that hip-hop was founded by a bunch of kids skipping through the ghetto, screaming peace, love, and unity, breakdancing, scratching, rapping, and holding hands. And as far as materialism, being fresh to death was the motto from day one. Obvious from the gold chains and name brand clothing rocked and rapped about on early hip-hop records. It might not have been Gucci, Louis, Fendi, or Prada, which was mostly due to the lack of access to luxury brands at the time, but trust, stunting has been a habit from jump when it comes to our culture. Now, some may say that in early hip-hop, all those things weren't glorified in the lyrics. And that's true, it wasn't prominent, but it was there. And this is supremely apparent in one of hip-hop's early and more popular chants. Make money, money, make money, money, money! You don't get more materialistic than that. And you don't get more criminal than the follow-up chant, which was, take money, money, take money, money, money! Imagine whole clubs full of original B-boys and B-girls singing along to that. But hip-hop purists will tell you that this...
Somebody just say, make money, money, make money, money, money!
Make money, money, make money, money, money!
Everybody say, make money, money, make money, money, money!
Make money, money, make money, money, money!
Is more hip-hop than this. It's the same exact thing, just phrased differently. Now, some of y'all might make the argument for skill, like MCs back in the day were more skilled. but at our culture's inception, an MC was just supposed to be the master of ceremonies. He wasn't supposed to be some lyrical genius spitting complex equations to make you think. The God MC himself, Rakim, said to him, MC meant move the crowd. Now, I don't know if y'all have been in a sold out arena or a packed club lately. When Future is playing, that crowd is definitely moving. Matter of fact, here's some footage circa 1986 of Schoolie D performing live at the Latin Quarter in New York City. Now, here's Future live at Club Miami. Once again, I see very little difference between the two. But you go to a real underground rap show, and it's a bunch of kids standing around waiting for the MC to get on. And when he or she finally does take the stage, it looks a lot more like idol worship than rocking a party. And that's what hip-hop was originally about, rocking a party and having fun. These underground shows are 80% dudes and a lot of kids from the burbs who are so far removed from the origins of the culture. Now, looking at those videos, you can see that the Future crowd is a lot more like the Schoolie D crowd, which is closer to the origins of hip-hop. And I know what you're gonna say next is the Honorable KRS-One says, you gotta have style, you gotta be original. And I feel you. But what's so distinct about MCs from the golden era? Schoolie D, Busy B, Steady B, names, cadences, beats were all so similar back then. But when Future dropped, he sounded like no one else. And I know because initially I would cringe every time I heard his voice. But complaining about his auto-tune is like complaining about people using the TR-808 back in the day. It's just a tool. There's a plethora of major label and indie artists that use the same tool and can't sell records. There has to be some skill and talent in what the man does, or else anyone can do it. Shit, King of Auto-Tune T-Pain would still be on the charts if that was the case. And let's not forget that this young man came up under and paid dues with one of the most talented and innovative crews in hip-hop history, the Dungeon Family. That's gotta count for something. But speaking of being innovative, let's talk about Migos, the group rap nerds love to hate. Three young men out of Atlanta who happen to be the most innovative group in hip hop since the 90s. Everyone is biting their style these days. This type of impact hasn't been seen since Das Effects dropped in 92. But Das Effects is considered real hip hop, and Migos are not. What makes Das Effects realer? Skill? Lyrical ability? Here's Das Effects' first hit, They Want Effects. Bum stickity bum stickity bum hun. I got that up, put up a pump pump, but I could be fire, bold diddly bum. Here I come, so feed a pipe up. I'm hyping up Pinocchio's nose, cause I'm a super califragilistic tic tac pro. I gave a oopsie, daisy, now you got the crazy. Crazy with the books, googly goo, where's the gravy? So one, two, buckle my, Sue Yabba do. Here's Migos' first hit, Versace. Cooking the dope like I work at Hibachi. Looking and watching blah highlights, I'm talking. Come to my room, my seat, Versace. When I go to sleep, I dream Versace. Medusa. These niggas, they wish it, they knew you. They copping the jewelry, missing the Louis. My blunts is feather exclusive. Figure straight shirt like I'm turning the tiger. Both songs were huge hits in the club at their respective times. Both tunes are really playful. But technically, the one considered real hip-hop is the least original, being that Das Effects borrows from nursery rhymes and TV jingles. Yeah, those catchy things that are in commercials. And you can't be more commercial than borrowing from a fucking commercial. Yet backpackers will tell you that Das Effects is real rap and Migos is commercial rap. Let's be honest, the only thing separating the two is nostalgia. Older heads used to get their groove on in Das Effects back in the day, so it holds a special place in their heart. But come on, bruh. Bum stickity bum doesn't mean a fucking thing. It just sounds dope and it works with the flow. So why is that better than Migos repeating Versace, Versace, Versace? It serves the same purpose. And at least Versace is a real word. In my opinion, both groups are equally dope and innovative, and both groups have had a huge impact on the game. Das Effects' influence stretched from kids like the Miggity Miggity Mac Daddy's Crisscross to grown-ass gangsters like Diggity Domino on the West Side. Migos, shit. Complex did a whole piece on their influence. Yeezy, Jeezy, even J. Cole. But let's go for another example. Dos Effects' last big song, Real Hip Hop, and Migos' more recent smash, Bad and Bougie. Scoob from Dos Effects brings it like this. So say yes to bust your caliber when I pop shit and rock shit like Metallica. Sticks through the heart, tell them snake fake niggas. Them all up in my face, jealous on my tape niggas. So honey, shake your fingers and show me what you got. Blow the fire, Dos Effects with the real hip hop. Offset from Migos does it like this.
We did the most, yeah. Pull up and goes. Woo. Yeah, my diamonds a choker. Wow. Holding up, I with no holster. Wow. Rid the ruler, diamond cooler. Cooler. This a roller, not a mule. Hey. Dabbing on them like the usual. Damn. Magic with the brick do voodoo.
Magic.
Court side with a bad bitch. Then I send the bitch through Uber.
Go.
I'm young and rich and plus I'm bougie. Hey. I'm not stupid, so I keep the Uzi.
Okay, so both verses mention fly women, being prepared for the haters, and they both make gunshot sounds in their ad-libs. And while Offset actually references real hip-hop by name-dropping rap legend Slick Rick, Screw from Dos Effects just references Metallica. Yet backpackers will tell you that Dos Effects is still the real hip-hop. Why? Because they repeat it a bunch of times in the hook? Because other than that, they both sound like real hip-hop to me. Or is it the production? A lot of boom bap purists feel like the beat has to have a sample in it for it to be considered real hip hop. But let's take it back to the KRS quote. You've got to be original. And what's more original than creating your own music from scratch? That's what producer London on the Track does. He made the Rich Gang hit Lifestyle, as well as numerous other tracks for various trap artists. But most recently it was announced he'd be collabing with real hip hop's newest savior, Joey Badass. So what happens here? Does London on the Track become real hip hop? Or does Joey Badass become a sellout? Sellout. See, you real heads are always so quick to throw people out of the culture. I mean, look at how they did Hammer in the late 80s and early 90s.
Hammer, shut the
And then Q-Tip hit him with.
Off the better things like a hip hop forum. Pass me the rock and I'll score him with the decorum and proper. What you say, Hammer? Proper. Rap is not pop if you call it that and stop.
Quick side note, Check the Rhyme is probably my favorite rap song of all time. And I got to squeeze it in 2 weeks in a row. Word. Anyway, these dudes were giving Hammer the business, mostly because of his mainstream appeal and the mound of endorsement deals he had. He had Pepsi commercials, a video game, his own tennis shoe, and even his own cartoon. But they harassed his brother so much that he eventually just dropped the MC from his name. I don't know if that's 100% why, but it felt like it. He was viewed as and blatantly called a sellout. Yet a decade later, when 50 Cent does some of those exact things, he's called a hustler and praised for his business acumen. Even conscious rappers like Nas, Common, and Kendrick have commercials and rep for mainstream brands. And nowadays, Hammer is viewed as a pioneer, hip-hop legend, and has achieved icon status. Hey y'all, no one has the power to throw anyone else out of the culture. If you don't like it, you don't like it. That doesn't mean that it's not hip-hop or that it's fake hip-hop. That's just as silly as East versus West or new school versus old school. There's room for it all. And thanks to technology, nowadays, it's a lot easier to find and focus on what you do like. That said, let's end this with another quote from KRS-One. In the Gospel of Hip Hop First Instrument, KRS-One says this, "For when all seem hopeless and oppression seem permanent, a caring, protective, nurturing creative force, independent of all the world's political, business, educational, and religious institutions, swept through our hearts and homes, and we were rescued from sickness, hatred, ignorance, and poverty with a behavior that we eventually began to call hip-hop." Look, what I think he's trying to say here is that hip-hop is a divine gift given to the oppressed peoples of the world to lift them out of their dire circumstances. And I like that idea. And whether you agree with what Migos have done with their gift or not, I believe they used it for its intended purpose. They are three young men who escaped the trap. What they do with that from here is up to them. I, for one, am grateful that hip hop exists to give me, them, and so many others the opportunity to do, be, and see more. And to me, that's what hip hop is all about. So real hip hop versus fake hip hop, is there really a difference? You might say hell yeah. I say fuck no. Let's talk about it in the comments below. And as always, for more music and news, check out HipHopDX.com. Hey y'all, I just wanted to show some love to everybody who's been coming up to me when they see me out and telling me how much they dig the show. Shout out to all the teachers and professors using us in their classrooms, my homeboy JB in OKC, Davey D in the Africana Studies Department at SF State, and a special shout out to the homies at the Tucson Airport. One of them actually asked me to take a picture, so I asked if I could flick it up with him, and boom, we have the world's first ever breakdown posse photo. So if you see me when I'm out, let's flick it up, and who knows, maybe you'll end up here. Thanks for tuning in. See you next week.